that kind of person whereby when you're not here, people know that, yeah, you're not here, you know? Tony, every time, you know, we start something.
We're in the room, and he says, good morning, guys, that man brings the energy. So,
who can't be my Tony here? Who's going to bring that energy?
Yeah.
One more time. Good morning, guys.
Good morning.
All right, so we're going to be doing the breakout session. This is for the college males and high school males. Pretty much we're going to be introducing Mr. Scott. Everyone knows him. I'm sure everyone enjoyed the first session that we had. If you enjoyed the first session, make some noise. So Devon here will give the brief introduction of Mr. Scott, and then halfway through the session, we will pass out evaluation sheets that we want you to please fill out at the end of the session, and we'll be giving out raffle tickets also. So which means we'll probably give out like 2 or 3 gifts to break out the session, to end the session. So I give it over to Devon.
Hello, my name is Devon. Like you said, well, I'm a transfer student here at Wake Tech, transferring in the mechatronic engineering program. And this is Dexter L. Scott. Dexter L. Scott is the owner of Dexter L. Scott and Associates, a Raleigh-based inspirational speaking and training company specializing in customized keynote addresses. Presentations and training sessions designed to provide you and adults with the tools to take them from where they are to where they need to be. Mr. Scott received his bachelor's of science degree from Indigenous City State University in Business Administration with a minor in management. Dexter is a native of Enfield, North Carolina, and is married to Tanya Jonah Scott. Along with his wife, Dex has appeared on the local television network. The Positive Life out of Goldsboro, North Carolina, was recently featured in the Huffington Post for their preparedness story and success in the network marketing industry. I've been featured in the Business From Home magazine on several occasions and have been selected to share a platform with the world's leading authority on leadership, John Maxwell, and Mr. Maxwell Growth Mindset, 15 Valuable Laws of Growth in the Network Marketing Industry.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Dexter Scott.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate it. All right. So, look, you guys, did you get something out of the keynote? Now, you know, here's why I asked the question. Here's my opinion of it. It really doesn't matter what I've done. It doesn't matter as long as you guys got something. See, that's the key. And sometimes we get mixed up in, you know, this is what I've done and blah, blah, blah. It doesn't mean that to me. It means as long as something that I said helped you guys. All right? So I know I got college in here. Do I got any middle? You guys? You college? I mean, high school. What grade? 11? 9? Okay. All right. That's a good age group. Okay. So we're just going to talk. I think I got what? About, okay. All right. So we're going to talk about some things. It's about the road to craft your way to success. There is a process to success. I talked about a lot of these things in the keynote. But one of the things, and I like to say I'm not any different than any other adult. We just all have things that we have to get through. We all have a process. That's just the bottom line, right? So now, this is important. Craft your way to success. This information was taken out of a book called Psycho-Cybernetics. Now, one of the things that I've done is I have studied and I continue to study those that have become very successful. What is it that had them to be any different? What's the difference between, Jerry, let me ask you this question. What's the difference between you and Warren Buffett?
Honestly, there's no difference. It's just, I feel like there's no difference between me and him because at the end of the day, everybody can be successful, whether it be small or big. Only thing you have to do is just work hard towards it and trust the process.
Mm-hmm. That's good. Well, okay, sir, what's your name?
Keith.
Keith, what's the difference between you and Jay-Z? All right, so he said he's rich, right? Well, okay, no, I'm telling you, here's the difference. Great answer. The difference is what goes on between your two ears. That's it. It's just information. Access the information and then acting on the information. Now, this craft method is powerful. This is a way of shifting and changing your subconscious mind. Now, I'm not going to get too deep into this, but here's an example. When you put on your socks and shoes in the morning, which foot do you put your sock on first? Right, left. He said, I only think about it, it's good, right? Right, left. Whichever one comes, okay, that's good. Whichever one comes first. All right, here's why I say that. That's a subconscious action. You don't even think about it. You guys have cars, you drive, you get in, you put your seatbelt on, you drive. It's a subconscious action. But now, that's a good thing. There are subconscious actions that are bad. They're bad habits that we pick up, and we take it into our lives. And we don't know how to stop doing some of these things. We don't know where it came from, right? For example, you know, our youngest children, Morgan is 11, Tyler is 9. Morgan comes home and says, Dad, I failed my math test. Now, what I say to her next is critical. Because I can say something to her that can put something in her mind, and she'll grow up saying, you know what, I'll never be good at math. You know, you heard me say earlier, I hate math. But I learned how to do it. Right? See, that's the thing. So, craft your way to success. It's called programming. Everything we watch on television is programming. If you don't believe me, this is what I want you to do. Go without drinking anything. And then turn on television, just for a little while. And then watch a Coca-Cola commercial come on. And you see the water just dripping down the side of that cup. And you're like, oh my God. You know, so you run and go grab a Coke. That's what it is. It's programming. And we don't recognize how programmed we are. Right? Now, here's something that you can implement. You guys, if you want to take notes, it's good. You're going to use it. You guys, high school students, I'm telling you, at some point, you will be introduced to having to make a decision about a good thought and a bad thought. I'm telling you, it's going to happen. Now, the C, craft. It's craft your way to success. The C stands for cancel. Now, this is going to sound crazy, but it works. Let's use math as an example. You're sitting in math class, and you just can't figure out this problem. And that thought comes across your head that I will never understand math. You need to actually say cancel out loud. Y'all practice. Say cancel.
Cancel.
That's what you have to do. Because, see, you can't say it in your mind. Because remember, in linguistics, if you say it, you hear it. It goes deeper. Say cancel.
Cancel.
Okay, somebody give me an example of something negative that crosses your mind often. Yes, sir.
I won't get to where I thought I was going to be.
Okay. How often does that thought come?
Not.
All right, so this is Mr. Hooker. So when that thought comes across your mind, you need to say cancel.
Cancel.
That's what you need to say. Because what you're doing is you're calling attention to that thought. You're attacking cancel to that thought. That's what you need to do. It works, I'm telling you. Just cancel it. Anybody else, you dealing with a negative thought? Let's think about it. Anybody else want to say? Yes, sir.
Failure.
Quit. Failure.
It's say something like quit. No.
Okay. How often does it happen?
It happens maybe when I'm doing bad in a class or something like that. Like,
okay.
Quit,
right. So see, the challenge is every time the thought comes, you say cancel, it's going to come less, and it's going to come less. Right? It's a process. Remember, just say craft. Craft your way to success. Now, remove the negative data. That's the negative data. All of us go through it. All of us experience it. It's negative data that just comes. Right? Some of us, you know, our parent might have said something to us. Boy, you're stupid. Think about it. It happens all the time. What are you talking about? You're stupid. You don't know what you're talking about. You're stupid. Now it drives. You're stupid. It drives. It drives. Now it's in your subconscious mind. Now when you try to do something, you're stupid is going to come across your mind. Guys, we deal with it every day. The R is replace. Okay? So now you cancel it. Now you replace that thought with another thought, a new statement about yourself. So in your case, it will be
everything that I want to be.
That's it. I'm going to be everything that I want to be. That's good. So you said cancer. I'm going to be everything I want to be. And it's just a part of your life. It becomes a part of your process. For you, failure, what will be your statement, your new statement?
I can do it.
Yeah, I can do it. So when that thing comes across, you're going to be a failure. Cancel, I can do it. Now, guys, it is like the affirmation that we read at the end of the keynote session. Successful people have affirmations. They do. You know, the videographer of Right Way International, you guys turn around and look at my buddy Adrian back there. Right? He owns his own business. He's a pastor in Durham.
Right?
Go, Greensburg. Yeah. So I can bet that he has an affirmation. We say it. We say it every day. I get up. This is me. My mind is the center of divine operation, and divine operation means the expansion into something greater than has ever been done before. My mind is the center of divine operation, and divine operation means the expansion into something greater than has ever been gone before. My mind is the center of divine operation. Divine operation means the expansion into something greater than has ever been done before. Three times. That's it. Three times. That's what I say. And I'm telling you, it goes deeper and it goes deeper. So you come up with the statement of your new you, because we're canceling the old data and we're entering in something new. So you come up with your own statement. What is it going to be? Right? It's the repetition of it. And you must say it aloud again. Now, let's go to the A. It's affirm, affirmation cards. This is important. You need to write down your statement, whatever it is, and you need to have it in a place that you're going to see it several times a day. You get up and brush your teeth in the morning, have it on the mirror. You have a car, when you get in, it's on the visor. You need to read it, and you need to read it. You need to say it, you need to read it. The more you do it, the more you're driving that state deeper and deeper and deeper into your subconscious mind. Because guys, everything that we do is subconscious. We have a decision. It comes from there. It comes from that place. So affirmation cards, focus, theater of the mind. All right? Now, let's do this very quickly. I want you guys to go on a quick journey. Everybody close their eyes for me. Everybody close their eyes. Imagine that you are pulling up in front of a movie theater. And you're so excited. You're just ready to see that movie. And you put the car in the park, you take your key, put it in your pocket, you open up the door with your left hand, you close the door with your left hand, and you start walking to the theater door. When you get to the door, the lady says, "What movie do you want to see?" You tell her the name of the movie, you slide your money through that little window, she gives you your ticket. You go and grab the handle on the right side with your right hand. And as soon as you open the door, the smell of buttery popcorn hits your nose. All right, you guys open up your eyes. Who smelled the popcorn? That's the theater of your mind. And you can access that at any time. That's powerful, right? So, okay, think about this. So you just smelled that popcorn. I did the same exercise with a group of students at a job call center. And I walked them through getting the popcorn, getting the drink, going into the theater, sitting down in the chair. And when it started going across the screen, they started seeing pieces of their lives that were negative. And when I told them to open up their eyes, half the room was crying. See, you can tap in to that place. I just walked you through an exercise that you can do yourself. You have to know how to tap into the theater of the mind. Now, there's a theater of the mind that is a reality for you. The things that all of you have experienced up until this point. But you can create a new theater of the mind. All right? And I walk this through with our team, the organization that we're a part of. I have them walk through the theater of their mind up to the teller and ask to take $50,000 out of the bank. I walk them through that because I want them to see that. And the more they see it, it will become a reality. But you have to keep digging, you got to keep digging, you got to keep digging. You guys good? Okay? Now, so the last one is train. Act as if. Act as if. Now, you guys saw that I studied. Some of you know Les Brown, some of you don't. I studied with him. This is powerful. Act as if means, what is it that you want to do again, Mr. Hooker? What's your ultimate goal?
Be an attorney.
You want to be an attorney. Okay, so you need to be an attorney right now. Y'all follow me. I need y'all to follow me here. I need you to be an attorney right now. When you walk into the room, you need to walk into the room the way an attorney walks in the room. When you shake people's hands, you need to shake their hands as an attorney because you are an attorney. All you have to do is catch up to getting the actual documents. But you're an attorney right now. See, when I said in my mind I'm going to be a speaker, this is what I would do. I would go in my bathroom where it's nice and dark. And I would just visualize myself going up on stage, talking to hundreds of people. And I would exit stage right, and I would take pictures with people. When I did that, 6 months later, it was happening. I'm telling you, this stuff is powerful. But you got to get it in your mind. You have to be that right now. What did you say you wanted to be?
Medical administrator.
A medical administrator. How long does it take to do that? In your mind.
2 years.
Okay. But you can be that right now. Right now. There's nothing wrong with that. See, here's what I learned by my mentor. We all got to have a mentor. My mentor used to sleep in his car, broke. And he said his mentor told him, I need you to go to the Mercedes dealership, find the most expensive car, and take it for a test drive. Now, he's broke. He's sleeping in his car. But his mentor told him to do it. And he did. And he did it. And he kept doing it, and he kept doing it, and he kept doing it. And now he has a dealer's license. He can get a Mercedes when he get ready. You see what I'm saying? It's the process. It's not about having it. It's about having the emotions to get you there. Once you experience those emotions, you will have it. I'm telling you, if I wasn't ready to stand on a platform with Kevin Harrington, who's earned $1 billion, I couldn't do it if I weren't ready. But see, he's a man just like I am. He just got more information. That's it. That is the bulk of it all. He just has more information. So let's take somebody else. What do you want to be, Michael? I saw you in the video.
Oh, yeah.
What you want to be, Michael?
I'm a culinary hospitality student, so I want to be own a restaurant.
Okay, you want to own your own restaurant. Okay, how many restaurants have you visited and talked to the owners?
There are a few.
Okay, so just do that. So you need to tap into what they do. And see, now it's going to start becoming a part of your reality. I'm telling you, man, this stuff works. All right, I'm going to ask my high school student. Somebody, what y'all want to be? Somebody give me something, okay?
I want to be, I want to have my own mentor in business, and I want to be a criminologist.
Okay, say that last part louder.
Criminologist.
A criminologist. Have you started going in and going around people who are already criminologists?
Mm-hmm. Like, do what I need to do and have that type of life.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so
right. That's good. That's good. See, that's the practice. Now, I told you guys the job that I was laid off from. I would get to a meeting, and I was responsible for setting up the whole room. I would sit from the University of Maryland to North Carolina State University to all colleges up in Virginia, Washington, D.C., all kinds of stuff. I would set the meeting up, and I would sit to the side and watch the people come in. Now, let's just take an example. It's an 11 o'clock meeting. I'm watching the people come in, and people would sit in the back of the room. And I'm watching, and I get agitated. I don't like for people to sit. If you all were back on the back row, I would be a little agitated. I would tell you, please come to the front. Why are you in the back? Right? But it kept happening over and over and over again. Then I got to the University of Maryland. The conference room that I was speaking in was beautiful. 1,000 people could fit in there. And I'm watching people come in from all cultures and all backgrounds. And they said, if somebody came in and sat in the third row, everybody filed in behind them. And I'm watching this. So I asked the person who ran that facility, I said, let me ask you a question. How many meetings do you guys do here a month? He said, oh, we do a lot. I said, what kind of professions do you have? And he said, oh, doctors, lawyers, engineers, blah, blah, blah. I said, where do they sit in the room? He said, believe it or not, they sit in the back of the room too. I said, wow. So I started researching. And I found a lady, she's a speaker also. She researched and she said she was in a meeting just like this. Everybody was sitting in the back of the room. A gentleman walked in the room late. He came all the way down to the front and sat right there in front of her. Now, he's late. She said the moment he sat down, all of the attention went on him. And at the break, everybody went up to him because he had the confidence to come down to the front of the room. It's about confidence. It's about confidence. You guys hear me? It's about confidence. It's about being the attorney right now, okay? There's a gentleman that I used to do mentorship work with. He said he was in a restaurant in Chicago. He and his wife having dinner. A lot of NBA stars are there. In comes Michael Jordan and his wife. He said the moment Michael Jordan hit the door, it's almost like the restaurant halted. And the people, these are other professional players, they watched him walk all the way to the back room where he had private dinner. And then it started up again. What was it? Confidence. They admire his confidence. And what I'm telling you is that they want to admire your confidence too when you start acting like an attorney. When you step up and be that person now. Be that person right now. So I challenge all of you. Craft your way to success. Reprogram your thought process. Okay? I need you to go to a dealership. Sit in the most expensive car. You guys are in high school? Okay. Go there and look at it. They can't keep me from looking at it, right? Right? Well, what kind of car you want? What's your dream car? Maserati. Man, go to the dealership. Right now. I'm giving you some keys right now. That if you take it, you will be driving a Maserati in 5 years. And you'll be like, that dude told me to just go look at it. Man, go sit in it. Smell it. You know, turn it on. Let me, you know, just put your hands on the stuff. Put your hands on the tire. I'm telling you, when you do that, it's going to begin to open up for you. Okay? Now, how are these two alike? Y'all respond to me. How are these two alike?
They both have patterns.
Yep. Okay, patterns. What else? Okay. All right. Anybody else? Okay. All right, now. Okay, good. A lot of similarities here. A seed reproduces itself after its own kind. Now, let's look at this, and I'm not going to get too deep here, but we have two minds. We have a conscious mind and a subconscious mind. The subconscious mind is the power, right? The subconscious mind, look to the left, you see, it's just a field. You get to plant in the field of your mind whatever you want to plant. Whatever. But now here's the thing. When you plant it, you're going to reap it. When you plant the seeds, you're going to see it again. So that's why you have to be very careful about the people that you're around, what you watch on television. I'm telling you. Now, there's a Harvard study, this was years ago, it said that you earn within $5,000 of the average of $5,000 of your closest friends. Okay, now, so Michael, if that be true, then do you want to hang around five guys who make $40,000 a year, or do you want to hang around five guys who make $10 million a year? See, that's what I'm saying. The conversations are different. It's very different. I'll tell you this. I love this stuff. I want you to go to McDonald's, sit down, and listen to the conversations of the people that are there. Then, I want you to go to Chick-fil-A and listen to the conversations that you have there. You see what I'm going with this? And then, I want you to go, even if you don't eat sushi, I want you to go in a sushi restaurant and just listen to the conversations. There are three different conversations. You choose where you want to go. Because see, a $5 Happy Meal, a Chick-fil-A combo, and a sushi roll cost the same thing. It's just where you go. I'm telling you, man, this stuff is incredible. The conversations are different. The people at Chick-fil-A are talking about different things than the folks at McDonald's are talking about. The folks that eat sushi are having a different conversation than the people at Chick-fil-A and the folks at McDonald's. It's a pattern. You expose yourself to the environment that you want to be in. Remember, my mentor said, man, just go. The guy told him, go sit in the Mercedes. Have the experience. Right? Tim, thank you. Okay? It's powerful stuff. Now, all right. Anybody ever heard of Acres of Diamonds story? Remember? Okay, y'all listen to this. I got 10 men. Y'all listen to this. So there was a farmer, an African farmer. He owned several acres. And he said, man, you know, he loved farming, tilling his land. And then he started hearing about the riches of people coming into Africa, finding diamond mines. Diamond mines. So he said, I want some of this. He sold his land for cheap. And he went and bought the equipment that he needed, and he started digging for diamonds in other parts of Africa. He went broke. He didn't find any diamonds. He ended up committing suicide. The person who bought his land was walking the land one day, and there was a stream that runs through it. He saw this big rock laying there. He picks the rock up and takes it into his house and puts it on his mantle because it looks good. One of his friends comes over a short time later and says, man, what in the world is that you got up there? Do you know what it is? He said, no, it's just a rock. He said, no, it's a diamond. Took the diamond, had it cut. It was one of the largest diamonds found on the continent of Africa. They were able to go and pull millions of dollars worth of diamonds off of that property.
He would have been rich.
No, so listen to me. Here's what I'm saying. Michael, your Acres of Diamonds is right here. Don't go looking nowhere else. Devon, Jerry, don't go looking anywhere else for your Acres of Diamonds. You got it already. Cultivate it. Cultivate it. Don't go nowhere else. See, you get on the track and you see somebody else over there and they look like they're doing well. Then you jump off your track and go over there. That ain't where you're supposed to be at. You see what I'm saying? Acres of Diamonds, all right? That's a powerful story. You can look it up. It's incredible, okay? Now, let me go through this very quickly so I can go ahead and end. Change the course. Now, remember, we said the subconscious mind is your power. Now, in this illustration, the horse is your subconscious mind. Y'all get this. The horse is your subconscious mind. The rider is your conscious mind. You can't make decisions on the subconscious level. You can make it on the conscious level. You get to decide right or wrong, whatever. But the subconscious is going to do whatever it wants to do. Prime example, I'm trying to lose some weight. But my subconscious mind keep fighting with me to eat the wrong stuff. I've got to make a change. Yeah, I got to make a change in my decision making. And it's not here, it's down in the subconscious mind. Now, here's an example. You get on a horse, you ride it. You go a mile, and you make a right. Go another mile, make another right. Go another mile, make another right at the point of beginning. So you just did a square. And you do that day after day after day. You do that for a whole year. Then you get back on the horse, and you decide, you know what, man? I'm going to go a mile and make a left. Boom. You pull that horse to go to the left. He says, uh-uh, I'm going to the right. And you're going to go flying off of that horse. Why? Because the horse, the subconscious mind, has been programmed to keep going to the right. It is a consistent effort of craft to change that subconscious mind. And you can do it. You can do it with the repetition. You can change. Then after a while, when you pull it to the left, it's going to go left. I'm telling you, this stuff is incredible. All right, so you guys take a picture of this. This is just three of my, I don't know if you can see it or not, but these are three of my favorite quotes. I'll say it. Albert Einstein says, the thinking that has brought us this far has created some challenges that the same level of thinking can't solve. William Shakespeare said, nothing is neither good or bad, but our thinking makes it so. And the last quote is Ella Willa Wilcox. Now, I want you guys to really listen to this. This is one of my favorites. She says, you never can tell what a thought will do in bringing you hate or love, for thoughts are things, and their airy wings are swifter than carrier doves. They follow the law of the universe. Each thing creates its own kind, and it speeds over the track to bring its way back to whatever went out from your mind. Okay? Now think about this. You get up in the morning. You guys are not married, anything, any kids, none of that stuff. Okay? So think about this. You get up in the morning. Somebody gets on your nerves. Now your attitude is just horrible. Then you get to class, and somebody piss you off in class. Then you're pissed off again, right? Then somebody step on your foot and you're ready to just go off, right? Then you go get something to eat. And the line is too long, but I gotta get back to class. Now you can't eat. You just pissed off the whole day. You know where that started? That morning. You chose to go down that path of negativity, and it appeared for you because you sent it out. I'm telling you, man, this stuff is incredible. So I think we're at our time, right? We good? How long we at? Okay, 11:30? Oh. Okay, did you have a question, sir?
I just have a comment.
Yeah.
If I may, because I don't want to ruin your time. So there's an example that's really similar to that.
Mm-hmm.
I like one group, their music. I'm sure y'all know who they are. The Chainsmokers.
Mm-hmm.
They have one quote that I saw on Twitter that was really good. They say, like, you know, people who say their whole day was bad, you know, they'll just say the whole day was bad, like you said. For example, like when you were saying about with the everything going on,
mm-hmm.
where it started from.
Right.
They say, was your whole day bad? Or was it just like the couple minutes that stuff happened?
Mm-hmm.
You know? They'll carry it over and say the whole day was bad.
Right.
When it really wasn't.
That's good.
It was just the situation that happened.
Right.
For that moment.
Yeah. Very good. That's yeah. great. Perfect example. Because its inception started that morning. And see, we get an opportunity to choose. We get an opportunity to say, I'm going to follow this path or I'm not going to follow this path. You guys know GPS, right? Okay. You get in the car and you're driving from Wake Tech to Crabtree Valley Mall. All right? You've got your GPS set. You decide, man, I need to get some gas. You pull off the road. What does the GPS do? It reroutes you. All right? You get your gas. As soon as you get back on track, you're good. See, that's how we need to get with our processes. Yesterday, I was tired. My kids were getting on my nerve. They asked me question after question after question. And I'm like, Jesus. So Tyler is my son. He's 9. He kept asking me questions. And I'm like, would you stop talking to me? You know, but I can't do that. So I said, okay, son, you know, it's fine. Daddy's tired. You know, that kind of stuff. Well, we have to be very careful because once we let it go, once you say something, you will see what you say. I'm telling y'all, this stuff is so incredible. Now, my wife and I, you know, and I'll share this with you just simply because it is the process of thinking. Years ago, I was asked the question, the reason that you don't make $100,000 a month because you haven't learned how to make $10,000 a month. The minute you learn how to make 10, you will get to how to make $100,000 a month. This ring I got on my finger is for $500,000 for the company that we work with. But this ain't the first time I saw it. Y'all high schoolers, y'all feel me? This ain't the first time I saw it. I saw it here first. I saw it here when that car was being repossessed. Y'all see it? I'm telling you. Man, if you guys get this, you will leave this conference, and 5 years from now, you won't even recognize who you are because you'll be walking on another level. You'll be doing things entirely different. Because, see, I have the story. I have the story of trying and failing. Have the story of losing the house. Have the story of losing the car. But, see, now craft. Think about craft. My wife and I just bought our home. We just moved in December. It's a $1 million house. Right? Well, here's the thing. When we started the process of buying the house, the thought started coming, you can't afford no house, man. You had a repossession. You had a foreclosure. You see what I'm saying? See how that cancel?
That's
what Nate is. Yeah, I'm gonna buy this house. This is my house. We went to the house every day. Remember I said you gotta feel it? We went to the house every day. The builder was there. I'm like, man, what's going on? We started feeling it. I started experiencing living in that house before we got in the house. And now we own the house. You see what I'm saying? I'm telling y'all. So get the picture in your head of what it is that you want. And don't you let nothing keep you away from getting it. Yes, you're going to have obstacles. Yes, things are going to go crazy. Yes, you're going to be like, man, what in the world is going on? But that's okay. And I don't have, I think this is my last slide, but I can still talk to you guys. How many of you all know, and I'm going to ask my high school students, how many of you all are hanging around friends that you know you don't need to be around? Oh, they laughing. See how I said that? Okay. All right. Okay, so the thing is, why are you around them? Right? Why are you hanging out with these guys? Just think about it. Yes, sir. Mr. Hooker, go ahead. It's where you feel comfortable. Okay.
That's who, you know how they say for people, if you don't tell your kids that they're you know, something at home, then when they hear from somebody else, they say, okay, this is what I'm going to click with.
Yeah.
Those are the guys they end up clicking with because those are the ones that make them feel special.
Right. Did y'all hear that? Would you all agree? Huh? So, okay. So, hold it, thought, Devon. So, if I were to take you guys right now and let's say, okay, we get on a plane and we fly to Silicon Valley out in California. And we hang around those kids. All those kids, $1 million, everything. Do you think you could hang out with them? Why? So you said no, why?
I don't feel comfortable.
Okay, you don't feel comfortable. Why you don't feel comfortable?
Because most of my friends I grew up with.
Okay, so that means that you don't want to meet anybody new. Okay.
So you were asking, if we were in an inner city state, or inner cities, and we were in a rough area, would we be able to hang out with the kids in that rough area?
Mm-hmm. No. So what it is would you be able to adapt in another environment? Your comfort level. Stepping outside of your comfort level. Basically what it is. Devon, you about to say something?
Yeah, I was just going to say, the reason why I was hanging around the wrong crowd, the bad ones and stuff, because I was scared of them, you know? And I wanted to be cool, but I was scared of them.
Okay. So he said he was scared of them and he wanted to be cool. I think that kind of go with all of us, right?
Yeah.
I mean, really. Anybody else got another comment? Yes, sir.
I would definitely, if I moved to California to hang out with this new crowd, I would be open to it because, one, if you don't, you know, put yourself in a new environment or be open and have a open mindset, of course, you're not
going to
get to a place you
want to
go to the market.
Right. That's good. Yes, sir.
So, yeah, I mean, initially, I would have some reservations, some, you know, guard my guard up because mm-hmm. it is a new area. However, he's right. If you want to succeed, if you want to be more in life and do things that you haven't done, you have to hang out with people that you've never hung around.
Right.
So,
yeah.
After I think of that, then I probably would hang out with them. And it'd be a measure of doses, because I'd still have my heart slightly, but I'd hang out with them, see what they're about, and then eventually.
That's good. That's good. I like that. Yes, sir.
What he just got to understand, I was seeing now in my head, and what you were saying a few seconds ago, it called the change of mentality, too.
That's good. Yeah.
And instead of being around the room and tell you getting into trouble and either that's somebody claiming you did something and did nothing, you got the cops running. But you go to another mentality, like you said, you see how other people live, and then, like he was saying, that it make you feel like, okay, this is a wake up call. I could do that. I could follow with new friends and new other community.
Yeah.
Come on, folks. find a common program and try to get into it and stuff like that, and they can put me on to it. Mm-hmm. Then after that, in the long run, like you were saying, it would show back. Okay, then that did change me a whole lot by doing whatever. It was me, mm-hmm. and then the stuff I'm going to do, I wish I had a chance to go ahead and be that unconfident. I like I'm right. equal a lot of people. I'm unconfident is equal. I like to be equal with other people.
Right.
Ain't like change nobody or nothing like that. I just like to be equal. I like to treat everybody the same. Mm-hmm.
Right. That's good. Now see, so you guys, the younger guys, that's wisdom.
Yeah.
See, that's wisdom. Just make a decision. Just do something different. Because, see, you're going to change. Yes, sir.
Next, I hear you talk about the information they need to obtain. Is there a book or an author that you can suggest to them to read that will help them get more information or so they can listen to online?
Oh, that's good. So, now, for me, I love two people. I mean, I love a lot of folks. But, listen, when I talk about that mind, and thank you for bringing that up, when I talk about the mind, you can actually live experiences. Put yourself in it. I YouTube a lot. Les Brown, write down Les Brown, L-E-S-B-R-O-W-N. Okay? And write down Bob Proctor. Bob Proctor. Okay? What's our time look like? You say 11:30? Okay, all right, so good. So, yeah, so that's what I do a lot of YouTubing. Now, for books, you know, I grab The Psycho-Cybernetics by Dr. Maxwell Maltz. I mean, that's some, I got to read it, you know, because it's that reprogramming. But Think and Grow Rich by Napoleon Hill, you need to get that. Think and Grow Rich. Now, guys, now, y'all listen to this now. It's not about the money. It is about the mindset that you will develop. So don't you want to be a person of resources? We all want to be. I mean, you know, if somebody come to me and they need $10,000, I want to be the person to be able to say, okay, I got it. So what do you need? Have that conversation. I don't want to be the kind of person to say, well, I just ain't got it. I want to have that conversation. Somebody else raise their hand. Yeah. Yes, sir.
Speaking about visualization and the power of visualization, and I was wondering if you could, for my students, I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about the obstacles to actually just being able to visualize and effectively mm-hmm. visualize.
Mm-hmm.
What are some of the obstacles, and what are some of the things that they can do to practice
mm-hmm.
Visualization and specifically effectively visualizing whatever it is they want to
right.
achieve.
Gotcha. Okay. So I'll use this is a good question. All right. Guys, this might be weird, but it is the power. You will be able to see how I can focus pretty good or I need some work. So the gentleman I studied under, he said, light a candle and look at the flame. And don't think about anything else. Don't take your eyes off of that flame. I tried that, and I was all over the place. But see, what happens, the more you do it, the more you do craft, the more you do it, the easier it becomes. So, all right, you see the red on this microphone. Everybody see the red on that microphone? All right? I want you to keep your eyes on the red of that microphone and don't move it. Don't think about nothing else but this, that's red on that microphone. How many thoughts going through your head while you're doing it? Like, why am I doing this? What in the world is this about? You see what I'm saying? See, now, the more you do it, so for the students, the more you do it, the more you'll be able to focus. The easier it will become to get tasks accomplished. So you're looking at the red on that microphone, right? And you're just staring at it. But actually what it's doing is it's working your mental capacity to focus. And I'll give you a prime example. The magnifying glass. Think about this. You have the power of the sun. You can harness the power of the sun into a little thing, and you can set an ant on fire. Well, how can you do that? Focus. That, what I call a magnifying glass? That magnifying glass takes the power of the sun and shoots it straight at the target and burns it up. It's crazy. That's the power of focus. I was told this. Here's the power that you have. You just need to learn how to focus it, students. All right. You listen to me? You got the yellow shirt? You listen? All right. Look, check this out, man. This is the power that you have. Think about the electric company that runs Wake Tech, the entire grid of power that runs this whole block. And it all goes down to that switch in the back of the room. When I flip it on, it comes on. When I flick it off, it goes off. We have that whole power grid at our access with the flip of that switch. You have the same power inside of your head. Same power. It's awesome. I hope I answered the question. That's an activity that they can do, that we all can do. Because, I mean, we all get off, man. I get off. I work. It's a constant effort to stay focused. So is it something, that was anything else I didn't answer? Or?
No.
Okay. Yeah. Yes, sir.
I would like to add to that, because I kind of got into doing stuff like that, too, is you really have to, like, you kind of spoke on this earlier, but about like meditating, you really have to know yourself in order to be able to do that too as well. So when you start doing stuff like that, you really have to channel into your inner self so you know.
I'm gonna tell y'all something that used to get me off. Crazy, man. Whenever I would turn to BET, my mind would just, looking at the women on BET, my mind would go down that road. Y'all, now think about this. You sitting at home, you're not doing anything, and you turn on a rap video, and all you see is all of that. Now tell me you're not going to turn that TV off and that stuff ain't in your head.
It's going to be there as soon as you close your eyes.
As soon as you close your eyes, it's there. It's there, MTV, all of that stuff, man. And now you can got all of it. All you got to do is pull it up. Now your head is filled. Remember, we get 50 to 70,000 thoughts a day. And this, it does not include all the stuff that can come through here. Okay, now, check this out. What if you didn't watch BET, but you YouTubed Les Brown?
You'll go to sleep feeling
that. And let that get in your head. Guys, my wife and I, some nights we go to sleep to Bob Proctor. I turn on YouTube, and I find a Bob Proctor that's about 3 hours long, and we go to sleep. Bob Proctor says he gets on an airplane from, he lives in Canada. He can leave Canada and go to any part of the world. Let's say the flight is 15 hours. Bob Proctor will get on the plane. The minute he sits down, he pulls out his calculator and starts playing with numbers. What does $1 million a day look like? What would I have to do to produce $1 million a day? What do I have to do to make $1 billion next year? What kind of products do I mean, he just, because see, remember, you're not accessing that part of your mind ever unless you decide to do so. So he consistently plays with numbers. So I want you guys, I want my high school students. So who's in the ninth? Do you keep up with them as they transition?
Yes, sir.
We try to. Yeah, because 5 years from now, I want to know what y'all doing, man. If you get this stuff now, 5 years from now, you'll be in a different place. See, 5 years from now, who wants to go to college? Okay? So 5 years from now, you can be in college, getting your education, and running a small business at the same time. You're making money, you're doing your thing. And now you're taking that money and you're putting it in the bank for an investment. You're not taking that money to go out and buy your BMW right now. You get what I'm saying? See, it's a process, right? It's a process. Somebody else had yes, sir, Jerry.
And I like to add to things like YouTube and reading books and stuff like that will help you to keep your vision, because, and the thing that you were saying today, it kind of remind me of that, because certain things I thought about of my past, I was just around it, and then now I'm doing it now based off my past. So it's just, it's stuff that you were saying, like being around certain things could will come back and haunt you, whether it be good or bad, yeah, whether you stay around it or not.
Right, that's good.
And that's to really add on to what he's saying, he was talking about this too, is like the music aspect of stuff. So if you go home and you listen to something and it's not provoking you to do something positive, then you know that the music's not for you either. You should listen to the music. You go home, listen to one song that's your favorite song after today, and then ask yourself, it's like, wow, did this have anything positive to push me to where I'm going in life?
Right. Right. No, this is going to blow you away, talking about music. So they did a study. They took two plants, one plant, second plant. They put a speaker beside both plants. They actually separated them. One speaker, they played classical music. The other speaker, they played rap and rock. The one that they played rap and rock music to, after a while, was leaning over like this. The one that they played classical music to had grown.
Really?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I'm telling y'all, man, if we can get this together right here, we can do anything. Yeah. That kind of hard boom, that stuff that just gets in your head, and those negative thoughts, our thoughts become things. Yeah. It's crazy. Yeah. Anybody else? This is a good conversation, by the way. I love it. All right. Yes, sir.
I think to sum up what you're saying is that it's best to use your imagination to order for you to get what you want, because visualization can help you through hard times and struggle. Because I remember a couple times when I started here, I sometimes think of me being successful. Like in high school, I remember being picked on because a lot of people didn't think I was going to graduate and stuff. But I also visualized myself like walking across the stage, and then I graduated within 2010, which is the one year I was supposed to graduate, which is using my visual and just believing in myself and thinking like, okay, they might say that, but I'm going to block that out and just say, I'm going to pass and get my diploma, and I did.
That's good. That's really good. So Shakespeare says, imagination is the preview of what's to come in your life. Our imagination is free, but we don't use it. Think about it. It's free. God, right now, y'all can imagine you can be in Italy somewhere. Drinking espresso. I mean, I'm just saying, you know, think about that. Nobody is saying that you can't do that. But the more that you tap into that imagination and the more that you use it, things will begin to move in that direction. Now, remember, I said, when you have a negative thought, I mean, it's very interesting. There's a quote, Robert Frost, he said, two roads diverged in a single wood, and I choose the one I get to go down. Let's travel by. Right? I choose the one less traveled by. So everybody's going that way. I'm going that way. Right? So now, here you are on that negative path. Somebody pissed you off, stepped on your foot. Now you're cursing them out. If you're driving in your car, you look at the gas, and you know, why do I have gas in my car? Oh, I ain't got time. You know, so you're steadily going out that negative path. And you keep going, and you keep going, and it gets worse and worse and worse. But like the GPS, at any time you can say, wait a minute, let me change this up. And you just go back to the point of beginning. And then you can go down that way. Yeah, it's really powerful stuff. And for me, now, I didn't learn this stuff in school. It takes the practice, the study of people who've done it. And I'll tell you right now, most of the successful people that I have studied have all failed and failed miserably because they chose to try and fail rather than stay in comfort. Comfort. If you choose mediocrity, you have reached your limit. But if you choose to step outside of mediocrity, now you're on a path to greatness. Yes, sir.
How did you become a motivational speaker?
Okay, so.
I know you were speaking, but I was just.
Okay, he said, how do I become a motivational speaker now? I truly believe that when you say, okay, God, what is it that you called me to do? He'll show you. Okay, I'm saying the jobs that I had out of college, or even in college, I started gravitating more towards speaking to people. Didn't know it at the time. Then I went back to my upbringing. I used to be the one who read the scripture in church. You know what I'm talking about? You know, I go over, Dexter, come on up and read the scripture. And the Lord said, may the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word. Then I can sit down, right? So then this lady named Miss Merrill would come up to my mom and say, oh, that boy going to be a preacher or something one day. You know, that kind of stuff. So anyway, I started looking at the jobs that I had, and I gravitated toward the communication aspects of what I did. And I said, wait a minute, it's something here. Now, this literally happened. My wife and I just carried on about our business. One night I was asleep, and Les Brown dropped it in my spirit. Never heard of him, never listened to him. I started studying him. I couldn't get enough of Les Brown. I YouTubed everything he had. Day in, day out, I would work out in the morning listening to him. I would go to bed at night listening to him. Like, man, what is getting in me? Then we flew to Vegas for a conference. 3,000 people in the room. We standing there, and they say, next to the stage, motivational speaker, Les Brown. He walks out on stage. I did not know he was going to be there. And I looked at my wife, and I said, this is what I'm supposed to do. Now, here's how you got to be hungry. He left that stage. He said, if anybody wants to look at studying with me, I'm in room such and such over at the MGM Grand. And he got off stage, 3,000 people in the room. He gets off stage, and his bodyguards take him that way. And I made a beeline. People were running behind him. I was at the front of the pack. I'm telling you, he run. I'm right there with him. I'm like, yeah, well, you know, because I knew this is what I'm supposed to be doing, man. So I was number 12 at the door. I was the 12th person to get in the door. And that's what started me studying with him for a whole year. That's how I know I'm doing what I'm supposed to do. Because when you have fun doing what you do, then you know that's what you're supposed to be doing. So that's kind of a nutshell, you know. Yes, sir.
It's crazy that he asked. I'm a mass communications major myself, and I was in public speaking, and we have to give like several speeches throughout the semester. And it was, I forgot exactly what I was talking about, but just the fact that I was up there in front of my classroom being passionate about what I was talking about, actually, but that's how I knew, I guess right then, that eventually I want to be a motivational speaker. I'm glad you.
Yeah, that's good. That's really good. Yes, sir.
So I just wanted, it's kind of a little circle away from what we've been focusing on.
Yeah.
But I wanted to ask you if you could tell us more about the impact of social media and your presence on social media, because I've been to like excursions or field trips to, you know, business companies, and then the potential employees are telling us of how much, you know, every single thing that, every time someone comes from an interview, they check their social media background.
And, oh, that's good.
This guy was telling us at Cisco of how, you know, he said he doesn't ever have any picture with a red cup on his social media. And
right.
He always wants people not to have that. But could you please just touch on that so, you know, everyone
can benefit. So did you all hear the question? So basically, the impact of social media, what it's having, kind of the do's or the do nots, right? So I'll tell you, young guys, just nowadays, we're in a different time. Everything follows you. Do not do anything and put anything on, okay, Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat, whatever. Did I mention the name? Facebook, whatever. It's so many of them. Pinterest, I don't know. Okay, don't put it on anything, okay? Because here's the thing. I was in college. Here I am, homecoming. I had me a drink. I'm standing out on campus with my drink. And I'm an alpha. I pledged alpha at Elizabeth City. I got my drink, right? And one of our founding members of Alpha on campus, he came. He said, young man, pour that in a cup. Get that bottle out of your hand. And I did that. I'm glad social media won't that back then, because it will be up there. Yeah, and literally, these companies are checking who you are. Look, if you got a girlfriend, you love your girlfriend, cool. Don't be laying up with her in a picture on social media. No, I'm being real. Don't do that. Because, see, you want to get that dream job. And the interview went well. And then they check your stuff after you leave. Like he said, you ain't getting a job. Because they don't want a person that would display that kind of behavior working for the company. You're the representation of the company. That's a great question. Me, now, yeah, there's a lot of stuff that go on that ticks me off, because I'm one of these guys that I like right stuff. I like righteousness. And when I know that people are doing wrong, I have a tendency, I kind of get pumped up about that. But I can't post that on social media. I'm a motivational speaker. My wife and I own a business. We travel around the world. I can't put that project. I can't have a slip moment of typing something crazy and it get out there. I can't do it because it's going to haunt me down. And it would affect my business. So I can't do that. You had something to say?
Yeah, another question.
Yes, sir.
I was wondering if you could share your perspective on time. And the reason why I ask is because just in dealing with students and even just in myself, you know, sometimes you set a goal and you kind of get caught up in the time that it might take to achieve that goal. And I feel like, especially with students, a lot of the times that is a barrier to going down the road to achieving the goal. So just what is your perspective on time?
Okay, so I want to answer that question, but I'm going to ask Mr. Adrian to come up here. Adrian, if you don't mind stepping up here. The reason I do that, my wife and I, Adrian and I, we work together. We've known each other for a few years now. But he owns a company. And he met us last week at the house. His structured time frame is nothing like I've ever seen. He has us marching to a beat of hitting goals. And my wife and I are held accountable. Because we're so busy, he says, I need this and I need it today. Right? So he was texting me this morning. The video crew is going to be here at 8:30. They're going to meet you. So I needed to be here. So I'm going to let him answer that because I admire his time consciousness.
Wow, wow. The question again is, what's your general perspective on time as it relates to achieving a goal? Have you ever gotten caught up in the amount of time that it might take to do something? And has that served as an obstacle to you actually achieving?
The only way to beat time is to have a plan. You must have a plan. And not just for a particular project, but for every day. I have a plan for every single day. So I'm a pastor as well. I have a business. I have children. I have multiple visions. So everything that's on my calendar, I have a point on it on my calendar. So I have on there personal time. What I need to do for myself. I have on there family time. I had to buy these roses for my wife. Spend time with my daughter because she needs help with her math. That's on my calendar. Then I have the list of my church, my business, all of my clients. What should I do today in this particular client? What needs to be done? So everything has a plan. Right in my phone, 3 o'clock in the morning, 4 o'clock in the morning, I'm mapping out the entire day so that by the time my wife gets up and children get up, they already know what needs to be done for the day. That helps me as a man to be on top of things, even dealing with a family as a leader, because your wife is going to wake up in the morning and say, what's the plan for today? What are we going to do about this? What are we going to do about that? And guess what? I already have it in place. Here's what we do. Man, my wife will follow me anywhere. Not because I have the most money, but because I'm a leader. And I always have a plan. In order to beat time, in order to be very punctual and get things done in life, everything has to have a plan. There is no success that just you stumble upon it.
Yeah.
Everything has a plan to it. So if I could submit anything to you guys today, to sit down, is to plan out your success and plan out what needs to be done on a daily basis. If you start that process and get it in your system now, then it'll affect every area of your life. So it's not just me being punctual for Dexter and his wife Tanya, but it's me being punctual for everything that I do in life.
Yeah.
Right? Thank you.
That's good. And y'all do that. So, man, see, I've never heard that kind of time. That's incredible. So, and I'll tell you a story, and this is awesome. Now, my wife and I, we've built ourselves up to a business. We've got hundreds of people inboxing us a day on Facebook. We cannot get to everybody. I have people asking me to be their mentor. I have to apologize to them. I can't. We just don't have the time. You know, it's just those kinds of things. Always happen. One of the gentlemen that I studied, he's a former NBA basketball player. He's a speaker. He makes more money speaking than he did in the NBA. He probably gets about $15,000 per session. He said he tried to get in touch with a multimillionaire on several occasions. the man would never return his call. He would call the office, the man would never return his call. He tried for a whole year. Finally, the man called him back. He said, Walter, you've got 1 hour. Meet me here. And he said he was waiting for the man to come up. The man got there, and this is what he did. As soon as he sat down, they started talking. He said, approximately 1 hour left, he said, Walter, thank you, man. It's been great. Boom, and hit the door. And he said he got offended at first. But then he recognized that all you have is time. When you learn how to master your time, I don't have an hour. I don't have an hour and 5 minutes to sit here and fool with you talking about. I've got another appointment that I've got to get to. So all of us in the room, if we can learn to master our time like Mr. Adrian, we'll be able to get more done. I'm working on it. I'll tell you, like when I leave here, I'm hungry, right? And I am on an eating plan, so I might stop and get me some protein or something. And I'm going to go to the house, and my wife is at home working, and I'm just going to chill out for a minute. Because, see, it takes preparation to do this stuff. I ain't going to throw nothing together and give it to you all. I want you to be able to eat it. So I've been working on this stuff for a while. So now I can chill out for a minute. We're getting on the road tomorrow. We're going to go to Miami for a week on vacation. See, it's that kind of schedule. Then we get back. Then we fly to Philadelphia. Then we fly to Jamaica. Then, and this is all business. Fly to Jamaica. Then we go to Cancun. I mean, it's just boom, 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 boom. That's the kind of lives we live, but we're getting better. So I thank God for that question, because it helps us all. Sir, are we on our time?
Thank you
all, man. I appreciate you guys.